Welcome to Chapter 9 of Algorithms 2. Chapter 9 is on fixed parameter algorithms. So what is this? So a practical observation is that even for NP-hard problems, we are in some cases able to find exact solutions, well, if the instances are somehow easy. But how does one characterize easy? Formal way to do that is to consider an additional parameter k next to the input size parameter that we are always using and analyze difficulty the problem in terms of this parameter. For example, a typical parameter could be the output size, or it could also be different things like the maximum degree in a graph, how far away a graph is from a tree is a famous parameter, where this definition of how far away is somewhat complex. So if you want to read more about the subject, perhaps have a look at the book by Rolf Niedermeyer, Invitation to Fixed Parameter Algorithms. So let's look at a concrete example, and this will be the example we will follow in most of this book. It's a vertex cover problem, which is given by an underacted graph. And in this case, we have an additional parameter k, which is the output size. So we are asking, is there a set v prime of k nodes such that all edges are covered by these vertices? So we are looking for k, or maybe up to k, vertices that cover all the edges. This is known as a vertex cover problem. So if you want to look at a fake application, you could think of the CIA wanting to bug the telephones of a terror organization, say, but they have to save some money, so they can't bug the telephones of all the members of that organization. They just want to do it for a sufficiently large subset so that they can listen in to all the telephone calls between members of this group. And the edges then would be the pairs of people in the groups that are actually talking to each other. I mean, fortunately, that's not the real application here, but it's maybe a simple way to remember what's going on. So why did we choose the vertex cover problem? Well, it's an easy problem. It's also one of the most classical NP-hard problems that have been considered. So there was a famous paper in the 1970s that looked at 21 hard problems, proved that all of them are NP-hard, and vertex cover was one of them. Also, it's a relatively simple problem. There's also a very simple polynomial time solution for fixed k. Namely, just try all subsets of k vertices and check whether they are a vertex cover. And that has running time something like n to the k plus 1. But that will not be sufficient for what we want here. What we want is that we cannot have something like input size raised to the parameter. We will see a more detailed definition of fixed parameter later. And also note that the vertex cover problem is equivalent to the maximum independent set problem. Namely, if you take the complement of vertex cover, you get an independent set. And if you have a smallest vertex cover, then the complement will be a maximum cardinality independent set. So now let's define more concretely what we mean with fixed parameter tractable. We say a formal language L is in the complexity class FPT with respect to a parameter K, if there's an algorithm with running time of the form order f of k, some function of the parameter, multiplied by some polynomial in n, but this polynomial must not depend on k, and this function must not depend on n. However, this function may grow as fast as it wants. It must be a computable function. That's the only restriction. And examples could be something like 2 to the k n squared, or even horrendous things like k to the k factorial times n to the 333. But more typically, we, or more desirably, we'll have complexities like a low-order polynomial, like order n, plus exponential function with a small basis, like 1.1 to the k. Have some look at counterexamples. N to the k would not be fixed parameter tractable. Even n to the log log k would not be fixed parameter, although this is, of course, in practice more desirable like such a function, right? But it's a formal thing. Not all fixed parameter tractable algorithms are really practical, but some of them, and not all algorithms with complexity beyond the range of fixed parameter are completely infeasible, like this one. So we will now first show that vertex cover is in FPT regarding the parameter output complexity. We will develop algorithms proving this, and we will use it also as a trying ground for introducing two important algorithm design techniques that also work for other problems, namely kernelization, that is a technique to reduce an input size without throwing away the essential part of the problem. In particular, for fixed parameter, one will try to reduce the input size to a problem of size order f of k for some function of k independent of n. So if k is a constant, that means it's a constant size input, and then of course solving that is possible in time independent of the input size. Another technique is a systematic search with bounded depth and ways to analyze such algorithms. So actually, for vertex cover, already a quite simple algorithm already proves that the problem is in FPT. Namely, this very simple depth-bounded search algorithm. So let's have a closer look at it. So it's a recursive function. Its input is a graph and a parameter k, and it returns just whether the problem is solvable or not. Base cases are, if there are no edges left, we have a trivial problem, we return true. If there is no budget left for putting vertices into the vertex cover, that's this parameter k, so k, if k equals 0, and there are still edges, then we cannot solve the problem and we return false. Otherwise, we pick any edge, uv, and see that one endpoint of this edge has to be in the vertex cover, right? So there's a simple two-way case distinction. Either we put u into the vertex cover or we put v into the vertex cover. And that naturally defines two recursive subproblems. Namely, we remove v from the graph and also its incident edges and make a recursive call with this reduced graph. And we also have to reduce an available number of vertices by one. And similarly, we can do a call on g minus u. So why is this correct? Well, the base cases are trivial cases, trivially solvable and a trivially impossible problem. We are free to pick any edge. And of course, there could be heuristics for picking a particular one, but that doesn't make the algorithm incorrect regardless which edge we choose. And one of these cases has to work. Running time. So these are simple constant time operations. Removing a vertex, well, that can probably also be done efficiently, something like degree of the vertex. But let's simply assume that we have to rebuild the entire graph. So that would be order n plus m, where n is the number of nodes, m is the number of edges. And we have a recursive call here, which has time t of k minus 1 if this capital T is a function bounding the running time depending on the parameter. Now, we have a recursion def of k here, right? Because with each recursive call, k is reduced by 1. So there, you have, in the worst case, a complete binary tree of recursive calls consisting of something like 2 to the k calls. Each of them takes linear time, so we would have a running time of order 2 to the k times n plus m, which is already within the framework of fixed parameter tractable. More formally, we could also say, okay, the running time or bound on the running time is a solution to the recurrence. T of k is n plus m plus 2 times t of k minus 1. And that also has this solution. So let's look at slightly more sophisticated algorithms for vertex cover. Here we look at a first very simple kernelization. So observe that if you have any vertex of degree larger than k, then either v is in the solution, or the problem is not solvable with size k. Because suppose we do not put v into the solution, then we somehow have to cover all its incident edges. But since there are more than k of them, we cannot do that with k vertices, right? And here's a simple algorithm that takes this into account. So it basically calls a recursive algorithm at the end, but before that, it pre-processes a graph in order to remove all vertices of degree larger than k. So first it uses, again, the simple base case of an empty graph. Then it repeatedly looks for vertices of degree larger than k. If this leads to a situation where k becomes zero, then the problem cannot be solved. Otherwise, it removes this high degree vertex and reduces k by 1, right? So we have expanded one vertex out of our budget. And the interesting thing about this is that this makes additional vertices eligible for this kernelization rule, right? And that's an important characteristic of kernelization rules. By applying them, you get more opportunities to apply them again and again. And this is somehow the magic behind kernelization, because then in many practical and theoretical situations, it really is able to reduce input size greatly. Okay, after this pre-processing of removing high degree nodes, we also do the contrary thing of removing isolated nodes, degree zero nodes, that may also have resulted from the removals here, because that also removes edges, right? And then if the remaining graph has more than k squared edges, then we say it's not possible to solve it. Stay tuned for why this is the case. And then we do the exponential time algorithms, the systematic search found death on this kernelized graph, on the kernel, one also says. So what about correctness? So this is according to this observation we made. Yes, so we already said we have no budget left, but the graph is also not empty, so it's infeasible to solve the problem. And in this situation, we actually know that the graph cannot be empty, which would be the only way to solve the case k equals zero positively, because we have found a vertex of degree larger than k, so there is as more than k here just left, right? And then at this point from this observation, if the problem is solvable, we know that it has to be part of the solution. We have expanded this capacity, so it's okay to decrement k. Removing isolated nodes is also no problem because putting them in the vertex cover is useless because they cannot cover any edges. And here we have to look a little bit more closely. Why is this a rule for rejecting the instance? So recall that we have removed all the vertices with degree larger than k, which means now we have a graph with maximum degree k. This implies that any vertex that is left can cover at most k of the remaining edges. But we can select only k of them, so we can at most cover k square more edges. If there are more than k square edges left, then there's no way to solve this problem. And this is very important because, in many practical cases, it will be the case that this rule somewhat reduces the size of the graph, but it might still be large. In particular, there might still be, we might have removed only a small number of vertices, maybe just n over 2, and then this is the number of edges and vertices left in this recursive problem is still a function also of the input size. But with this rule, we now can say, yeah, but this graph can have at most k square edges, right? There's not much left. What about running time? Well, we can remove a vertex in this while loop at most k times, right? And we said that removing a vertex takes at most linear time. So the running time for the pre-processing is at most k times n plus m. This is this term in the running time. And then we have a graph with at most k squared edges. And of course, and also since we removed isolated node, at most k square nodes. So by plugging in the running time for our exponential time algorithm, we get a bound of 2 to the k squared for this part. So in an interesting exercise is how can we reduce this to order n plus m, so linear in the input size plus exponential in the parameter. Okay. So let's look at an example. So let's consider this graph here. And we want to know, is there a vertex cover with 6 vertices? So we have identified here this red vertex, which has degree 7. So we can remove it according to this kernelization rule together with its incident edges. Then we have to answer the question, is there a vertex cover of size 5 for this smaller graph? Well, there's a vertex of degree 6 here, so we can remove it at its incident edges. That means we have to now ask, is there a vertex cover of size 4 for this smaller graph? Well, here's a vertex of degree 6. We can also remove it and its incident edges. Now we have a remaining graph for which we look for a vertex cover with 3 vertices. Well, maximum degree is 3, so this is fine. We cannot apply the kernelization rule again, but now we can check how many edges are there. Oh, these are 11 edges, but with vertices of degree at most 3, we can cover at most 3 times 3 is 9 edges. So without looking at this further, we can say no, there is no solution with size 6 for the original problem. So let's look a little bit more at how far can we drive this. Particularly, it's interesting to look at more reduction rules. So we have already used a reduction rule for degree 0 vertices. They are not part of an optimal cover, so we can remove them. So maybe let's systematically look at a larger and larger degree of the vertices. A degree 1 vertex, you can see the rule here. So this edge, the only one incident to this vertex, has to be covered, right? And well, there may be optimal solutions covering it with this vertex, but we can always replace them by a solution where we actually select this vertex for the cover, because it also covers the edge, and potentially it can cover other things, right? So we can, in a degree 1 vertex can always be removed from the graph. And an interesting small exercise that follows from this is perhaps consider how to compute a vertex cover for trees in polynomial time. Okay. Degree 2 is more interesting. There's a general kernelization rule for degree 2 vertices, but we will use it only in a very simple form, namely at the very end. So not as a general kernelization rule that may trigger other rules, but we do it at the very end, and we remove all other vertices. And then it's actually quite easy. If you have a vertex, a graph of maximum degree 2. So all the vertices have degree 2, basically, because we have reduced degree 0 and degree 1 vertices. And this graph simply consists of cycles. And we can simply take every other node within this cycle. So here's this picture shows this. In an odd cycle, we take every other one, and that's optimal. In this case, also in an even cycle, this is obvious. In an odd cycle, this we might consider this a problem, but it actually turns out it is not, because we will actually have to take half the vertices in this cycle rounded upwards to really cover all the edges. And we have already seen this rule where we can remove vertices of degree larger than k. And yeah, man can consider further such rules. If you look into the literature, there are quite a number of more of them. Actually, Damian Hespe is an expert on this. He was part of a team who won an implementation challenge on solving vertex cover as well as possible. So maybe in the exercise he will explain more about this. So let's put this into an algorithm, these simple rules that we discovered. So we have these special cases for empty graphs or k equals 0. And now they are embedded into a branch and into a systematic search algorithm. That's actually also an algorithmic pattern that's called branch and reduce, so that in every recursive call, you may also get additional opportunities for applying your rules. So in particular, we will apply here the degree one heuristics. And we say, okay, we have a recursive call where we select the neighbor of the degree one vertex for the cover, which we can do without loss of generality. And then we remove that vertex and its incident edges. And we will actually, as a side effect, produce a degree zero vertex. V itself will have degree zero, and it will then be removed later. Oh, actually, we don't have an explicit rule for removing degree zero vertices here. It doesn't matter. I mean, what happens if we have a subproblem where none of these rules fires, then there may actually be vertices with degree zero, but we can simply ignore them, right? And also in this call. Okay, so we again and again use these rules to recursive calls, and then when we get here, we are in a situation where all nodes have degree zero or two. And we have seen that this is a very simple problem that can be solved in polynomial time or actually in linear time. Maybe as an exercise, think about how to implement this vertex cover for a collection of cycles. So how do we analyze this algorithm? We can now take this more formal view of putting up recurrence equation describing this. I mean, we have a linear time algorithm for this, and also linear time for removing vertices and things like that. So within this thing, including the final case here, it's linear time plus the time for solving a problem of size okay, sorry, I have to backtrack a few seconds. So I want to argue that the running time of this procedure can be somehow described by this recurrence. Linear time for something that happens within this thing, including this vertex cover for a collection of cycles call, plus the time for two recursive calls, namely that are these two. One, where k is reduced by one, this is this recursive call, and one where k is reduced by at least three, because if we do not put v into the vertex cover, we have to put all its neighbors into the vertex cover, and there are at least three of them, right? So now we get a more interesting recurrence, namely t of k is n plus m plus t of k minus 1 plus t of k minus 3. So why does this recurrence hold? It's a bit ugly. So maybe for seeing that better would be more easy if instead of making this recursive call, we would simply say g equals g minus v, and then postulating that we use a dynamic graph data structure that does this removal in time, constant time, basically. And then all these reductions rule applications would be covered by this n plus m term. Okay. in this recursion, it might be less obvious because then one might say, okay, this graph is copied, and then, yeah. But anyway, that is only simple polynomial factors. The more interesting thing is that if we solve this recurrence, and this can be done systematically, for example, using methods of generating functions or simply using a computer algebra system, we get a solution that looks like order n plus m times some number to the k, but this number is significantly smaller than 2. So we still have exponential time in k, but the basis of this exponential function is considerably smaller than k, which basically means that we can solve inputs that are a constant factor larger than with the trivial algorithm. And in practice, this turns out to be quite significant. Then maybe you can go from solving instances of size 20 to instances of size 100 or so. And that might be important for a wide range of practical applications. So without going into the details, I just want to mention that there are further improvements here. One can achieve kernels that have size not k squared, but 2k. By the way, using matching algorithms, one can reduce the time for the recursive calls to constant using the right data structures. And making a more detailed case distinction, one can even show a running time of this form, so not 1.4 something, but just 1.2738 to the k plus order kn. So this is an additive term. The problem-dependent part is just the kn term, and then this is independent of the input size with a really quite small base. So let's summarize what have we learned on fixed parameter algorithm. We see that important subclasses of NP hard problems can be solvable in polynomial time. And more generally, kernelization is an important strategy in pre-processing. Or also techniques that we can use within the algorithm for a wide range of optimization problems. And that's not restricted to fixed parameter tractable ones. We can do it for even harder problems, but also for polynomially time solvable ones. For example, for the maximum cardinality matching problem or approximations thereof, this has been used very successfully. And even more abstractly, making brute force algorithms like depth-bounded search, slightly less brute force, sometimes leads to significant speedups. And one way to formulate it is that for a fixed input size, the running time may go down exponentially. And there are also some non-trivial analysis and design techniques here, like designing kernelization rules, analyzing complicated recurrence equations, and so on. So there's quite some know-how in this direction that I think might be useful for a wide range of problems. So thank you very much. This ends our chapter on fixed parameter tractability.